happy Sabbath and welcome to all.
And happy day.
It is a beautiful day out there and a wonderful day to be at church with you all.
Amen.
I'm here to do the welcome and remarks. So we'll start off with sad note. The Rochelle Birch is moving from us and going to Georgia. We're going to have a picnic. Possibly a picnic. I guess that's open to interpretation depending upon the wind. But we're going to have a lunch with her in the picnic area after the services. And we wish her well in her future in Georgia. Yeah, that's the other thing. The board's working on that. let's see. Kickball last week. I was not on the blue team, but the blue team did win. So we'll give them congratulations. There was minimal destruction, so that was good. I don't think there were any ambulances involved this time, so that was very good.
One?
Oh, it was a fun time. Okay, yes, it was. We had a blast. Okay, April birthdays. Melly Williams was on the 9th. Cameron Barlow on the 11th. And Risa. Is Risa here today? Risa, could you please come forward? I have a gift for you. Reese's on the 20th. Yep, happy birthday. And Kwame's not here, so it is dead. We'll give it to his father. He's on, what's the date?
27. Should ask mom.
I picked the date. There we go. So let's see. We have a work bee on the 21st. Next week, all are required to come out.
Attendance is mandatory.
Please see Elder Ed Fabian for instructions and details. On April 28th, we have the ladies' paint day. It's 2 p.m. on the 17th. Oh, okay. Yeah, sorry. It's on the 28th. Please RSVP to Jessica by the 17th or Latarsha. There's a $10 charge for supplies, so you'll pay in the envelope, mid-market for the women's ministry, or online for the women's ministry. So if you're interested in painting the ladies, please come out on the 28th. Mark your calendars for Spring Fest on June 2nd. Volunteers are needed. VBS is on July 31st to the August 2nd. Volunteers are needed. Please reach out to Jessica for these things. We have our regular meetings for the second Friday evenings. The Fire Pit Vespers are at 6:30 on Fridays. Tuesday night, prayer and study, 7:30. Friday night Vespers, video presentations at 7:30. And the third Sabbath is potluck in the food pantry following the service. And board meetings, to which all are encouraged to attend, are on the first Mondays of every month. Sunset today, 7:43. And that is it for the announcements for me. I will now hand it over to whoever's leading us in song.
Happy Sabbath.
Happy day.
That's right.
Blessed assurance. Jesus is ours. And Jesus is mine.
462.
Jesus is mine, all I have for the sake of glory divine.
fill us, Lord, with your Holy Spirit. Pour out, Lord, the former rain, that the fertile ground of our hearts might be ready to receive the latter rain in due time. This we pray in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen.
Amen.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. Psalm 119:66 says, "Teach me good judgment and knowledge, for I believe your commandments. Teach me good judgment and knowledge, for I believe your commandments." The church is now called to worship.
Amen.
To God be the glory. Hymn number 341. Shall we all say? To God be the glory.
Now we are going to glorify God. And so please don't do it. Let us glorify God. What?
Amen.
Sister?
To God be the glory. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord indeed. Okay, I'm here for today's offering. And today's offering goes to the world budget, specifically the Hope Channel International. Give hope through your offering today. The impact of the Hope Channel is evident in the inspiring stories of God's children, like Pastor Ross and baby Aurora. Ross overcame drug addiction to become an ordained Seventh-day Adventist pastor after discovering the Hope Sabbath School. Following baby Aurora's brachial plexus injury at birth, she was miraculously healed thanks to our most watched Let's Pray program and prayers on her behalf from our global community. With your offering today, Hope Channel can continue to share the transformational love of Jesus Christ with the people all over the world by producing high-quality Christian content to reach new audiences in innovative ways. Our Hope Study platform is online and offers, I guess it's ourhope.study platform, is online and offers Bible studies on a range of topics. So far, over 300,000 people have started a course just 1 year after the platform went live. People are hungering for Bible truth. Amen?
Amen.
As we read in Proverbs 11:25, whoever brings blessing will be rich, enriched, and who waters will himself be watered. By faithfully supporting Hope Channel International, you are not only blessing others, but yourself as well, by bringing hope to those who need it most and by telling them of the love of Jesus Christ. After celebrating 20 years of Hope Channel and reaching over 80 countries with the Adventist message, let's make 2024 the most impactful year yet in sharing hope in Jesus with people everywhere. Amen. May the deacons please come forward. Rise. Please bow your heads. Dear Lord, we give thanks for all that you give us in this life, all of your blessings, and we are allowed to give back just a portion to show our appreciation. May these blessings that we give back be used to do your will in this world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
It's now time for the young people to come up with the children's story.
But before we call Miss Samantha up for the children's story, we're going to collect a children's offering. Who wants to pray before? There you have it. There it is. All right. All right. You want? All right. Come. Well, I'll tell you what. Look, come over here with Mateo. All right. Emily and Mateo are going to pray. We're both going to pray. You're both going to pray, right?
Amen.
All right.
Amen.
So, Mateo, you go first, and then Emily, okay? All right.
Dear Jesus, thank you for staying in my mom and daddy and my friends and cousins and angels protecting us in our house, and I hope we can have an amen.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you, God, for food, clothes, and shelter to give us strength. Thank you for dying on the cross for us just to save our lives. Bless our family, bless our friends. Guide Auntie Rochelle on the drive to Georgia and protect her, protect all the people in this church.
Amen. 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 Maestro, take it away.
The Bible tells me little ones to him belong. They are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so. Jesus loves me, he who died heaven's gates to open wide. He will wash.
Huh?
Child, come in. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so. Jesus, take this heart of mine, make it pure and holy thine. On the cross you died for me. I will love and live for thee. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so. When I'm good, when I have been traveling so long
with this heavy load, it's weighing me down. Oh my, I can't manage this. This is too heavy. Anyone wants to help me? All right, Jacob. All right, help me. Feel it.
Careful. Okay. All right, let's put it down over here. Oh. Okay, let's put it here.
Woo! Happy Sabbath, boys and girls. How are we doing today?
Good.
Sounds good. Wow, I'm tired. This bag is really heavy. You wonder what's in it? Yes? Something?
Something big.
Something big. Oh my goodness. Now my story to you this morning is entitled, What's Weighing You Down in Your Backpack? How many of you have a backpack for school? Oh. You have a backpack too, right, Mateo? You have a lunch bag, right? Two. Well, this is my backpack for school. It's not that heavy each morning, but I actually prefer to take a backpack than to have a handbag and another bag. So, coming to Maryland has taught me a lot. And the people at my school, they're very simple. They're not fussy, so I go with the flow. And this does it for me. And it's a very strong bag. I've had it for almost 3 years. Yes. Now, you wonder what was weighing me down in that bag? And it's just what weighs us down every day. So I'm going to reveal some of the things that was weighing me down in this bag. Oh, man, it's hard to even get them out. Oops, what's on this? What's weighing me down? Hate? What is hate? Oh, wow. Now that's deep. Is there anyone who hates something or someone? Have you ever hated someone? No? Or something? Pardon?
I didn't like someone.
Oh, you didn't like someone. Oh, so do you know that it's the same as hate? To dislike means to hate, right? You don't love it. You don't like it, right? So this is one thing that actually will weigh us down. And what do I mean by weigh us down? When we are filled with hate, does that make your heart happy or glad? No. All right, I need to put this down. All right, let's see what else was weighing me down. What's here?
Anger.
Anger. Wow, that's heavy. But hold on. I think I have a double dose of anger in here. Oh, anger, more anger. Uh-oh. Woohoo, wow. Have you ever been angry? Anyone? With someone? Yeah. Yes? No? Yeah. Maybe so? How long have you been angry for? Pardon?
2,000 years.
A long time, right? Okay, so, I mean, as adults, we get angry. And, you know, it's not a good thing. We should not let anger weigh us down. But I'll move on until afterwards. I'll tell you the remedy for some of these things. And what else weighs us down? Lies. Oh, my goodness. The weight of a lie. A guilty conscience. Have you ever told a lie? Just to get out of something. And how did it make you feel?
Kind of good, kind of bad.
Kind of good, kind of bad. That guilt that weighs on you, right? All right, listen carefully here. You know, because sometimes some people call it a white lie. Oh, it's just a little lie. And the thing with lie is you tell one, and then before you know it, you have to tell another and another because you got to keep that story, right? Let's see what else weighs us down. Ooh. Oh, my goodness. What's this? Greedy. Greedy. What does that mean?
Want something, you're jealous.
Oh, wow. You're using one of the words I have in the bag, too. You just want everything for yourself and yourself alone, right? Sometimes it can be food. You just want all the food and you don't want to share it with anyone else, right? Greed can really weigh us down. And I have more. Do we know what this means?
Malice?
Have you ever had a friend that you decide that I am not talking to you? It's going to be a long while before I talk to you again. You know, and you turn your back on the friend and like, I'm going to malice you until you say you're sorry or until I feel like talking to you again. And sometimes it's just having malicious intents. So malice can weigh us down. And Emily said the last one, because I also have
jealousy.
What's jealousy?
Jealous that someone has something. For example, like if someone's rich and you're poor, you're gonna be jealous of them.
Someone has something at you and you want it and you're like, why does she get to have it? Why does he get to have those nice blue Converse shoes or those lovely pink shoes? What do you call those, Aubrey? I'm jealous of you. They're probably cheap. You understand? Sometimes when we're jealous, we say mean things, right? It's kind of like they say the fox can't get the grape. He says it's sour. Oh, I bet those are not even that expensive. I could get my own. Wow. Now, that was a whole lot, right? That's quite a bit to weigh somebody down. Now, I have another backpack that I think I prefer to take up. Now, doesn't this look a lot sturdier, like it can protect you from anything? Rugged for camping, right? This is not heavy, right? Feel it. Even Mateo can carry it. So light. Do you think anything is in this backpack, Mateo?
Yes.
No.
No? Yes? Okay, hold the mic for me, please. Jacob? Or okay. Woohoo! There is somebody in the bathroom. Oh, my goodness. I'm trading my lines for? What are we trading lines
True.
For? What are we trading lines for?
Truth.
We are trading lines for
truth. And John 8, verse 32 says, then you will know what is true, and that will make you free. The truth shall set us free. And John 8, verse 44 says, all lies come from the devil. All right, and we are going to trade malice for peace. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. All right. Jealousy can be replaced for admire and praise. Wow, Aubrey, I love your shoes. They're cute. And Emily, those are some nice shoes you're wearing, and I love your hairstyle. Instead of being jealous, right? So Psalms 19, verse 14 says, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Now, because it's not only what we say, because people will have jealousy and it's in their heart and you can't see it and you can't hear it. So that's why we have to pray that the words of our mouth and the things we have in our heart are acceptable to God.
Amen.
Greedy will be replaced with kindness or sharing. Because sharing is caring. All right. And also, for those who say, you know, I'm not going to talk to her, you can learn to forgive. Forgiveness, it says in Matthew 6, verses 14 and 15, if you forgive those who do you wrong things or do wrong things to you, God will forgive you. But if you do not forgive other people, then God will not forgive you. All right, then we have for hating, there is always
love.
John 15, verse 12 says, this is the rule that I give to you. You must, not may, you must love each other in the same way that I loved you. Won't these things really make for a lighter conscience? You don't feel guilty. You feel free when you love. You just, it's just, you're, it's bubbling over. And I just want you to understand what these negative things can do to our lives. It makes us sad. It brings you down. It weighs down on you. You feel guilty when you should be free. And so I just want to encourage you to love. Be a friend. All right? It says a man who has friends must show himself friendly, but there is a friend who sticks closer than a brother. And we know that that friend is Jesus. Thank you so much for listening. And would anyone like to pray? Thank you, Emily. Okay, heads bowed, eyes closed.
Thank you, Jesus, for this Sabbath day and to learn this special message. To not be mean, jealous, or not truthful. And always to be the best self you can, treat others with kindness, respect, and the way you want to be treated. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Emily. That was wonderful. Have a great day, everyone.
Happy Sabbath. I wanted to call Miss Joy, Miss Kristen, Miss Heather, Miss Cecile, and Miss Samantha. And we're going to call Jacob and Emily up. So on behalf of the children's department, we have some good news. and some sad news for Miss Christian and Miss Joy. But we have a promotion today of two young, beautiful children of God. And they're actually going to be moving on to their next chapter. So sad that Miss Christian and Miss Joy is not going to have them anymore. But they are going to, it's exciting that they're going to continue the next chapter of their growth with Jesus with Miss Heather and Miss Cecile.
Jacob and Emily, I've really enjoyed being in class with you each Sabbath, especially the children's Bible study. I've gotten to know you much better, and so I wish you all the best and all the blessings, spiritual blessings that you'll be gaining with Miss Heather in the new junior class. Thank you so much for all your help and your lovingness all through the years.
Whoa.
All through the years, and we love you so much.
Amen. Amen.
Yes, I have thoroughly enjoyed having them in our Sabbath school. They're always willing to help and cheerful and happy and thankful for the mothers who bring them and raise them up and work with them in the week. And I just continue to pray for them as they move on with their growth.
Amen.
Myself and Cecile would like to welcome Jacob and Emily to our new PowerPoint junior class. We welcome you both and trust and hope that you'll continue to grow and learn in the Lord.
Amen. Amen. Thank you very much. We wanted to shake your hands, Emily and Jacob. So you guys can just come down the line. We'll shake your hands.
We're
excited for this new promotion with you all.
Oh, look to your right.
No.
Right, yeah. I got a vat. As a matter of fact, I'm going to bring that up now. You're going to need this in a few minutes, I'm sure. Good morning and happy Sabbath. Jacob, Emily, congratulations. That's awesome. That is very, very awesome. It is now time for our intercessory prayer. There's a number of burdens on my heart that I would like to present before the Lord in prayer. One is our sister, Donna Fabian. Many of you know the health struggle she's been going through, and I just want to make sure that she's mentioned and placed before the throne of grace. Also, our brother Charlie Nixon, who's now down with Lisa and his grandson Dean. We traveled down there last night. Charlie's always very fond of my wife's ponset. So Lynn took over a dish of ponset yesterday to Charlie, and I'm sure he seemed like he was happy to receive it. I also want to remember a coworker of mine, Frank DeBeal, who right now should be going in for a CAT scan right about now. He was found having a brain tumor, and they operated on him apparently successfully, and he seems to be doing much better, but they want to make sure that they've captured all of that, and I just want to lift Frank up in prayer as well. Now, this is the time where we open it to the floor of the congregation. I've said my piece. We'll open up to the congregation. If you have any burdens that you've been carrying that you'd like to lay before the throne of grace, or any praises that you'd like to uplift, you know, please raise your hand and the deacons will come to you and you will be given a microphone. Joy, go ahead.
Yes, my sister is coming to visit me today. She's coming all the way from Oregon by way of London and France. So I'm grateful that she's had good flights all along the way, and I'm asking for blessings for this week. Thank you so much.
Amen. Outstanding. Yes, well, yes, Stefan, go ahead.
Praise the Lord for my brother Johnny coming in to church with us this Sabbath. It's a blessing. It's a blessing. So much more to learn and to grow in Christ, and I'm excited for the journey.
I'm glad that you acknowledged him, Stefan, so I didn't have to. Welcome, brother. Amen. You found a home here. Please.
I also wanted to praise the Lord too. Just for my friends here. Basically, like without them, I would have probably been heading towards the wrong direction. There's a lot of things I let go of, because I seen them let go of it. We were all heading honestly towards the wrong direction. So it's like basically having friends like this. It's like you have someone to walk this path with. Like you don't feel alone doing it. So I just praise the Lord for that. You know what I mean? Because like, I don't want to perish. You know what I mean? I want God to say he knows me when he comes down. So.
The words I long to hear on that faithful day are, well done, thy good and faithful servant. Enter into the rest of the Lord prepared for you from the foundation of the world. I know a thing or two about going the wrong direction. I spent a lot of my life heading the wrong direction. You know? And I wound up here. Who's next? Go ahead, Wally.
I had a patient this week. She's an OBGYN, and she's working with underprivileged kids in Edgewater. And she asked me if I would come and help work with her, which I'm going to. And then I had another patient yesterday. I said, would you like to study Bible studies? He said, sure. And so I'll gather the stuff up, and we'll set up time up after Joy's sister leaves. So I'm very thankful that the Lord uses us to reach people.
Amen. Amen. We got Mimi over here.
Happy Sabbath, everyone.
Happy Sabbath.
You know, it's amazing. Every time, Steve, you always call out for us to praise him and make it known. I cannot be quiet because God is just such an amazing God. You know, and to hear the young men testify right now, it's like I always try to tell people that there's this God who loves you in ways you can't even begin to imagine, who's not afraid to get his hands dirty. I don't care whether you're believing for a child of yours who hasn't found their way back yet, whatever, a relative, a parent, whatever it might be, know this, prayers never expire, and God is listening. And the thing about it is, whether we know it or not, when somebody's praying for us, God does. So please stay faithful. It's not about judging or watching what they are doing. Look at God. Trust me, even when you don't think he's working, he's working. You know how I know? Because I'm sitting here today. I should have been dead a long time ago, under the prison somewhere. But because of Jesus, here I sit today. And I just want to praise him for being so, he's just mind-blowing. Every day, God just, you know what I mean? Like, when I'm faced with storms, sometimes I'm like, no, Mimi, I don't need somebody to testify to me. I testify to myself about how good God has been in my life. If he didn't bless me another day, he's done more than enough in this one lifetime for me. You know, it's not about things. It's about knowing who he is. And he keeps revealing himself to us if we seek him. There's nobody here better than another or worse than another. Amen. He loves us equally. God is about to bring some people up in here, and we better be ready with hearts full of love, amen, without judgment, because he's bringing them from everywhere. So we have to pray as a church that we are able to receive people that are hurting and are lost, and they can come here and say, I don't know what they have in there, but I want to go back there again, just like I did. Because I said, I don't know what's going on in 1996, but I'm going to keep going there. And I kept coming. And let me tell you, God keeps blowing my mind. He ain't even done yet. He ain't even finished yet. I haven't touched the tip of the iceberg yet. Amen. And on top of all of that, this week, out of nowhere, clear blue, God brought a job into my lap that I start on the 22nd. I still have a job, by the way. I didn't have to lose the job to get another one. He just gave me a promotion with another company. And then when I went to resign from my old current job, my boss said, hold up. You don't have to resign. We will take you PRN, meaning you get to pick whatever hours you want when you can. Talk about the God that we serve. You know, we have not, for we ask not. We have too little. And I don't want to pray for things, because things will perish. But I want to pray for the incoming of the Holy Spirit, that latter rain that quickens my spirit to his spirit, because Jesus is soon to return. It's not about whether I'm saved. It's about going out there and making sure that people that are lost get to hear about this Jesus that saves us every day. Amen.
You know, I want to share with you all something that I've learned. A burden shared is a burden divided. A joy shared is a joy multiplied. Get on with the program of divine mathematics, folks, because that's how it works. Mary, I saw your hand.
I just want to say that. Oh, hang on, wait a minute.
Oh, welcome back.
I left a couple of a family in West Virginia to come here. And I just want to pray, because they didn't know exactly which way to go and what to do. And she was adopted and raised in a Seventh-day Adventist church as a child. And she's an elderly lady now with her son, and so they need your prayers and Amen. Guidance, I guess.
Amen. Amen.
Happy Sabbath. Sorry, Grace. I didn't see. I apologize. Continued prayers for my husband and how I interact Amen. With him. I know I'm guilty. Sometimes I don't show Jesus when I do interact sometimes. So prayers for me and him and Mateo and our children and the children in the world. Another thing, too, is, you know, we have our VBS and our Spring Fest and all with the effort of the church. But again, the Lord have a hand in that. As we pray, and I know people say they may not be able to be there or whatever, but remember, prayer. You can Amen. Pray for it. Please pray for this, Amen. these things that we're doing as a church for our community and planting those seeds. And we know the time is near. Amen. Also, praise to, I know I'm saying, help me with this, pray for this, pray for this, but you know, a year ago, in January, I had a back surgery, and I know leading up to it, I was praying and praying, please help me, you know, with that surgery, and I was in so much pain, and I just was talking, I think, Steve, to Lynn, and this week, and it came up, and it was like one of those things, like, oh yeah, how was that surgery? You know what, I haven't given enough praise. For me to be able to sit down for this long Amen. Was like impossible before. Amen. So I just gotta praise, you know, it's been a year. I'm not at 100%, but I'm at 90, 92, wow. 95%. So Amen. I just gotta remember those. I can ask and ask and pray, but I gotta remember the praise, you know? Amen. So just a little reminder, they're having that conversation this week.
Amen. So, Amen.
And thank you, my church family, for being mentors and guiding me and helping with the relationship with Jesus, because I definitely need it.
Amen. 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 Go ahead, Grace.
A couple I work for, I went on Thursday, and before they left for vacation in Florida, a conversation come across and about our religion, the Seventh-day, about they want to know much about Seventh-day Adventists. And anyway, I collected some of the, it is written literature, plus the great controversy we shared around the community. Well, good news is when I closed from work, the wife saw me off at the door, and she said, oh, we read everything about, and the next time you come, we will have discussion about it. So I'm praying for the Holy Spirit to be with them and be with me also. Any question that might come across, the Holy Spirit will speak through me. And the whole started that they didn't even know that Christ is coming again. They are in their 70s. So I pray, it's my prayer that they will understand everything they read or they have read, and the Holy Spirit will help us to draw close to them. So I need prayers for them too.
Amen.
Happy Sabbath, everybody.
Happy Sabbath.
So most of you know I have a younger brother, and it's been a while since he ever came to church or even thought about God. But last Thursday, he joined me and Patricia in Bible study. And I just like saw a new side of him, and he really wants to come back. So he's going to be joining Bible study with me every Thursday. So he's going to be coming to church soon, too. And praise God to be alive today, to see everybody here.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I'll tell you this. We got a chair here for him. You know, we got a chair here for him. Amen. Who's next? Are there any other? Go ahead, Vince. All right, wait. I see Kavina, then I see you, Vince. Go ahead.
Kavina goes last. Praise God for my church family, as always. And I just, as usual, for the past 20-something years, I'm always at a loss for words. Not getting here. But you hit the nail right on the head. Mimi, 1996 Generals Highway is the place to be. Amen.
Amen.
I don't know where else you'd want to be at this time, you know. I mean,
this morning, when we were studying the Sabbath school, we came across a word, fighting, battle. And Satan is using so many kinds of weapons. Right? And one of his missiles is sickness and illness. So please let us remember our brothers and sisters, our family members who are sick and who are on the sick bed. Let us remember them.
Amen. Are there any others? Are there any other silent requests that can be acknowledged by the uplifting of your hand? Great. Thank you. We will sing our prayer song, number 671. Then, if you are able, I would invite you to go to your knees in prayer. Or if you'd like, come to the front. Now, dear Lord, now as we come to you in prayer. Father God, many burdens have been laid before your throne, and many praises have been uplifted for the blessings that you've provided. Lord, most of all, as these doors are opened, we want to be known as a loving and welcoming church. We want everyone who walks through that door, whether they've been coming here for 20 years that the church has been open here at 1996 Generals Highway, or they've walked through the door for the very first time, to feel the warmth of love that we have here. We want them to feel welcome. Because, Lord, I don't know what it took to save anybody else here, but it took the death of the spotless Son of God to save me. Father God, we want to welcome our brother Jonathan into our midst. I hope that he finds what he's looking for here, Lord, because like myself and many others here, the world has nothing for us. Lord, we think of the families that we have here, Lord, and we're drawn to our families, Lord, and they have a very near place in our hearts. And we think of Joy's sister coming to visit, and we ask for her traveling mercies. We think of Yehemi's brother, Lord, and the journey that he's been on that has led him to Bible studies with his sister and Patricia. And Lord, we just know that there's great joy in your heart to see that. And Lord, we just ask that whatever he needs, Lord, that you will provide for him. Lord, we think of the praises that Mimi has uplifted. And Lord, we see how actively you've worked in her life and are continuing to work in her life. Lord, we think of Mary and her family, and we just ask that you continue to bless her, Lord. We've missed her. She's been gone a long time. But Lord, she's still part of our family here. Lord, we think of all the activities that we have going on in our church, VBS and the Spring Fest, and all the things going on, and we just ask that you bless them, Lord, that they may be pleasing in your sight, and that they may be blessed with the spreading of the gospel, Lord, and that hearts might be touched in a very special way. Father God, we think of those who we come in contact with by divine appointment, and we would just ask, Lord, that we are given a word to speak in due season, yes, but able to meet their needs on a very personal level. Lord, I ask the forgiveness of our sins here, Lord, whatever they may be. I would ask that mercy be upon us and the blood of Jesus cleanse each and every one of us from all unrighteousness. Lord, and if I might, I would ask that a double dose of your Spirit come to rest on your speaker this morning, that he be an instrument in your hands, that he speak not the words that he would speak, Lord, but the words that you give him. Lord, all these things I pray in the precious name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior, and for his sake, amen. Amen. Amen.
Today's scripture reading is taken from 1 Corinthians 3, verse 18 to 20. I will read in your hearing. It says, "Let no man deceive himself. If anyone among you seems to be wise in this age, let him become a fool that he may become wise. For the wisdom of this world is foolishness with God. For it is written, he catches the wise in their own craftiness. And again, the Lord knows the thoughts of the wise, that they are futile." This is the word for today. Our speaker is Brother or Elder Fischer. He's receiving in care of the Holy Ghost.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, sister. There are two things I would like to add to the intercessory prayer that I had neglected to mention. Sister Rochelle, you will be missed. And I pray that wherever your journey takes you, that God will be with you, and you will be the blessing to your new church family that you have been to this one. Now, I voted against letting you go, but I was overruled. Yeah. I also want to remember, our sister April wasn't feeling real well today, and I just want each and every one to keep her in prayer as well. She was feeling under the weather, so she returned home. You know, brother, at a point in my life when I too was going the wrong direction, I developed an interest in astronomy and cosmology. You know, when I graduated high school, I was able to go to work at NASA out in Greenbelt, and I was fascinated by all those things that they were studying out there. I up until recently, a few months ago or so, many scientists, as a matter of fact, the vast majority of scientists, believed that the universe was 13.7 billion years old. Now, scientists also believed that the universe consisted of three components, with visible matter, which is the stuff that we can feel, see, and touch, dark matter, and dark energy, with dark matter and dark energy making up 95% of the stuff that's in the universe. And the stuff we can see and touch is only 5%. In an article I just read recently, one scientist suggested a new theory that there is no such thing as dark matter and that the universe is actually 26.7 billion years old. So within the last 2 months, the universe has aged over 13 billion years. Think about that for a moment. I consider myself, as I think all of us should, as a perspective of being Christians, a student of human behavior, watching human nature in action and in reaction fascinates me. We are, as human beings, a fairly curious bunch in more ways than one. I think that we can all agree on that since that fateful episode in the Garden of Eden where curiosity and disobedience overtook our first parents, fallen human nature, hasn't changed a whole lot. The human experience has, for a very long time, thought much higher of our own intellect than I think we ought. We enjoy contemplating ideas, concepts, models that pander to our desire to see ourselves as intelligent. From Cain to the people at the Tower of Babel, through the Old Testament, with far too many examples to list, even up to our present day, we appear to be pretty enamored with our own intelligence. And those feelings of accomplishment seem to be amplified when we gather together in groups. Larger groups seem capable of lunacy that is well beyond any individual. And once a person or a group of people can convince the unwashed masses that they are operating on a higher intellectual plane, or more simply stated, in the group of smart people, they can, through tactics like fear and other forms of manipulation, can engender support for any idea, no matter how crazy that idea may be.
take a look around and you'll see examples of plenty. A couple of points here before I get into the meat of the message. In the last statement, I don't say the people doing the manipulation actually had to be smart or be intelligent. They only had to convince others that they were smart by any means available to them. Point number two is if you find yourself trying to convince other people of how smart you are, that might be something you want to take a look at. Third point is I am in no way disparaging intelligence, being smart, being intelligent. For being smart, being intelligent, when well leveraged and well used, I find intelligence to be one of the most admirable traits and characteristics a human can have. But if and only if it is coupled with a measure in equal parts of faith and humility. I'm going to give you all my credentials for standing up here. All right? I'm not a theologian. I'm not a biblical scholar. I haven't studied at seminary. And I'm not as well read as I probably should be. In fact, if you took all of my college credits and added them all up, I would have enough to be a first semester freshman. But there is nothing, absolutely nothing, that I can find in the Bible or the Spirit of Prophecy that lists academic achievement or intellectual acuity as a prerequisite or as a qualification for salvation. But the inspired Word of God does say this: fear of the Lord is the beginning of both knowledge and wisdom. Today, I want to look at how God used smart people, but how these smart people that God used were filled with faith and were foremost humble and faithful people. You know, Joseph, he was a pretty smart guy. Devising the plan to get Egypt through the severe famine that was to confront them was pretty slick. Particularly in light of the fact that just mere hours before, he'd been in the prison. You know, I mean, he was locked up. He came up with this plan. And as a servant of the chief warden in the prison, significant historical events always fascinate me in the way that they impact or have the potential to impact the trajectory and course of the world's history. I submit to you, saints, is it possible or even likely that Egypt's rise to power on the world stage was set in motion, at least, if not set in motion, at least helped along by Joseph's plan for Egypt to not only withstand the famine, but to prosper during it? Clearly, that plan had the divine fingerprints all over it, and it set the stage for our next example, but this was only possible, God using Joseph to deliver the plan for the storage and dispensing of grain due to Joseph's faithfulness and humility. Joseph's journey started with his dreams, and we can certainly debate the prudence and judgment he displayed by sharing them with his brothers, particularly the second one, but the twists and turns with which his life takes that culminate with Pharaoh calling him out of the prison, trying to contextualize those into a series of life experience like Joseph's seems almost impossible. And yet, with all he'd been through, standing in the presence of heathens, when asked to provide an interpretation to the dreams that were troubling the leader of the most powerful nation on earth, and I would invite you, if you have your Bibles with you, to turn to Genesis 41, right? And we're just going to read the first part of it. And Joseph says to Pharaoh, "I cannot do it." Now stop reading right there. "I cannot do it." A couple of things to note here. First, Joseph doesn't come into Pharaoh's presence and exhibit any animosity toward the cupbearer for forgetting him for 2 years. There's some humility there. He doesn't come in and start promoting himself or claim abilities and skills for himself that belong to God and God alone, in spite of the fact that God had used him in the same capacity previously. Again, humility. But he says, I cannot do it. Now, what if Joseph had stopped right there? What might Pharaoh's reaction have been? I don't know if any of you had seen the first Star Wars movie, but there's a scene in the movie where there's a hologram of Princess Leia, and she's talking to Obi-Wan, and she says, Obi-Wan, you're my only hope. You know, I can imagine Pharaoh looking at Joseph and saying, Joseph, you're my only hope. I need you, man. My entire team could not interpret these dreams. And I hear all these wonderful things about you, how you have the gift of interpretation, and you can't help me, Joseph? What am I going to do? Could you imagine what Pharaoh must have been thinking in regards to the cupbearer? Yes, excuse me, Mr. Cupbearer, can I have a word with you? I think that it might have ended for the cupbearer in the same way it ended for the chief baker. Now, let's keep reading, shall we? The next two words that Joseph speaks, but let's set them in context. Joseph says, I cannot do it. That's right, Joseph, you can't. You know, but the next words, but God, what? Oh, I'm sorry. 41:16. I'm sorry. 41:16. I get out ahead of myself. You know what? Let's stop here. We're going to stop right here, right now, and we're going to take time, and we're going to pray. All right? Father God, I am but a man, but in your hands, Lord, and only in your hands, I can be used to great purpose. Use me to purpose, Lord, that you would have me. For, Lord, as I prepared this message, you were with me, your spirit was with me, and, Lord, I don't know if anyone else here needs to hear this today. You do. But I do know this, Lord, that I am preaching more to myself than to anyone else. And I would ask, Lord, that this message take root in my heart. You know, and that it also take root in the hearts of others who need to hear it. This I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Again, we're in Genesis 41, verse 16. Right? He said, but God... And it's all right there. God will do what Joseph cannot. And God will do what we cannot. But God will give Pharaoh the answer he desires. When we stand ready to give God the credit, to give God all the glory, we will be amazed at how God can use us. Do you think Joseph woke up that morning in the prison, thinking that by the time he went to bed that night, he was going to be second in command of the entire country of Egypt? I'll tell you this, if he had a thought anything like that, it never could have happened. Joseph accepted the station that he was in. Whether he liked it or not, he stood ready to give God the glory for all the blessings he had received and stood ready to give God the glory for all the trials he endured, seeing as how they were preparing him to be used by God in a mighty way. Joseph was a smart guy, but he wasn't chosen to be used by God because he was smart, because he was handsome, or he had any other admirable human quality. Joseph was chosen because he was faithful. Joseph was chosen because he was humble. Moses was a pretty smart guy. He was well educated. We have to at least agree he was well educated, right? He was educated in the finest schools in Egypt. And he was part of the royal family, likely heir to the throne. A fair amount of time passes between Exodus chapter 2, verse 10 and Exodus chapter 2, verse 11. But I am certain that Moses was being raised by Pharaoh's daughter. He was provided the best education and schooling. I'm sure a lot was expected of him in terms of academic performance. If you take a look at all the things that ancient Egypt contributed to the modern world, there's some things here I didn't know. Did you know that the Egyptians were the first one to come up with a 365-day calendar? Egyptians were the first to use papyrus and ink. about 2,000 years before the Chinese invented paper. They were skilled in mathematics and geometry, as evidenced by the construction of the pyramids. They had advanced medical procedures and understanding. Now, these weren't an average bunch of dullards that Moses was hanging out with. He was able to associate with the best, the brightest, the smartest, and most intelligent people of his time. From the time Pharaoh's daughter's maid pulled the basket from the river until the day he heads off to Midian, Moses had the best of the best of everything, the creme de la creme. He had the best with regards to schooling, food, clothing, housing, associations. You name it, Moses had the best available. And Moses knew that. Now, for the vast majority of people, and I suspect a fair percentage of us gathered here today, that would be a pretty heady experience. But it didn't seem to faze Moses. In fact, if we read on through Exodus, Leviticus, into Numbers, we see in chapter 12, verse 3 in Numbers, we read the following. The word of the Lord says this: Now the man Moses was very humble, more humble than all men who were on the face of the earth. I submit to you, saints, if ever there was a man who could provide justification for dispensing with humility, that man was likely Moses. Raised in the king's palace of the most powerful kingdom on earth at that time, chosen specifically by Almighty God to lead a nation of captive slaves across the Red Sea and out of captivity, appointed, again by Almighty God, to a leadership position to administer justice over all the people, which was likely a group of a million or more, chosen by God himself to act as an intermediary between God and the people, and the Spirit of inspiration says he was the most humble man in all the earth. Throughout the 40 years of wanderings of the Israelites in the desert, there is one and only one recorded episode, the waters of Meribah, where Moses acts out of character. Now, the question we might ask is, how do we know that there was only one occasion of Moses acting in a way displeasing to God? A couple of reasons. First, and this serves to support the authenticity of the Bible never seeks to gloss over the flaws of its major and central characters. Not Abraham, not Jacob, not David, not Solomon, not Peter, and certainly not Paul. The Bible brings forth the entire picture of the man central to its narrative, warts and all the warts. Second, it is specifically mentioned by God at the end of Moses' life as the sole reason given that he is not able to enter the promised land. And third, if there were other episodes of malfeasance in Moses' record, I suspect that God would have replaced him in his position of leadership. For the period that they were in, coming into the promised land with all the typology that went along with it, it was simply too important to have tarnished by repeated transgression on the part of Moses in the role he was in, particularly in sins of pride. Moses never abandons humility for self-exaltation or tells the congregation how much more qualified he is for the leadership position than they are, even when his own brother and sister try to usurp his authority and position given to him by God. He is on record as trying to lift himself up. He's never on record as questioning God when God leads them into, and most importantly, through some very tight spots and trying times to test their faith. When the Israelites found themselves hemmed in by the mountains on the south and the Red Sea before them, seeing the Egyptians closing on them for the rear, to all human understanding, they were done for. To human understanding, there was nowhere for them to go. The mountains were impassable. There were no boats or vessels sitting on the shore for them to get across the Red Sea. And the totality of the Egyptian army, the largest and most powerful in the world at that time, was closing in on them. The people, trusting in their human understanding, were terrified. Seeing nowhere to go and facing in their minds what was certain doom and destruction. But here, Moses never wavers and issues the statement that is a clear manifestation of Proverbs 3:5. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. So let me ask you, saints, do you think Moses did not see all the same temporal obstacles that the rest of the Israelites saw? Did he not see the Red Sea before them, the mountains to the south, and the Egyptians ganging on them from the rear? There is no indication in Scripture that I can find that he had any advance information on God's battle plan than any other of the people that he was leading. And let's be truthful here. Moses was certainly the best educated of the entire host he was leading. And not trying to conflate education with intelligence, but he was likely the most intelligent too. But in complete trust in the workings of an all-powerful God, Moses says this to the people: do not be afraid. Stand firm. You will see the deliverance of the Lord will bring you today. The Egyptians you see today, you will never see again. The Lord will fight for you. You only need to be still. God wasn't able to use Moses because he'd been educated in the finest schools in Egypt, or that Moses was intelligent, which is a gift of God, or handsome, or personable, or any other favorable human trait that God, that Moses may have had, that God may have blessed him with. God was able to use Moses because Moses was humble. God was able to use Moses because Moses was faithful. God was able to use Moses because Moses trusted God. Before I get to my final illustration here, I want to detour for a minute. Maybe we'll call this a sub-point of illustration. Nicodemus in John chapter 3. In John chapter 3, Jesus calls Nicodemus a ruler of the Jews, and later Jesus refers to Nicodemus as the teacher of Israel. Jesus recognized Nicodemus was a smart guy, but he plainly tells him that being a smart guy ain't enough. The road to heaven isn't dependent upon a person's intelligence, perceived or real, not one's social status, I don't care how many followers you have, or their wealth or political position. Nicodemus had all of that, but there was still lacking something. Praise God for that. And praise be to God that Nicodemus walked away from his interview with Jesus with the understanding that he was missing something, something crucial. And further praise be to God that Nicodemus was able to find what it was that he was missing, and that in finding it, that missing something, his whole life was transformed from someone who thought what they knew, or what they thought they knew, was sufficient, to someone who realized a complete dependence on a blessed Savior for redemption. My last point of illustration before we get to the points of application is Daniel. He's another smart guy, and he's a favorite in Adventist circles. Let's be honest. We all love ourselves some Daniel. There is a lot to this story as it relates to the message this afternoon. I'm going to start in verse 3 of the first chapter, and I'm going to go through verse 5. But before I do, I want to take a moment to examine the contributions of the Babylonians where Daniel was held captive have made to our modern world. And here, again, were a lot of things that I didn't really know. One of them I did. The Babylonians developed trigonometry. I didn't know that. They used mathematical models to track Jupiter and other planets and develop concepts of the lunar month. They were one of the first cultures to use irrigation in agriculture. The Babylonian hanging gardens were one of the seven ancient wonders of the world. I didn't know that. There were some pretty bright people, these Babylonians. But on to the text. I'm going to begin reading in verse 3. The king ordered Ashpenaz, the chief of his court officials, to bring into the king's service some of the Israelites from the royal family and the nobility, young men without any physical defect, handsome, showing aptitude for every kind of learning, well-informed, quick to understand, and qualified to serve in the king's palace. He was to teach them the language and literature of the Babylonians. The king assigned them the daily amount of food and wine from the king's table. They were to be trained for 3 years, and after that, they were to enter the king's service. So right away, we see that Ashpenaz recognized that Daniel and his three friends were smart guys. It never makes mention that Daniel or his friends told the Babylonian official that they were smart guys, or that they set about trying to impress Ashpenaz with the fact that they were smart guys, or had any recommendation or commendation from anyone. I am not sure that Daniel and his friends came from nobility or a royal lineage. Given the apostasy that existed in the house of the king at that time, that Daniel and his friends came from Israel's royal family, in my mind, is a pretty tough argument to make. The heritage of Daniel and his friends is really not that important, but it does serve to reinforce the point of how impressive these young men were. Now let's skip down to verse 8, and I'm only going to read again the first part of the verse. But Daniel resolved not to defile himself. And we're going to stop right there, at least for now. And I think our health minister in the back would want me to continue reading the rest of that verse. That might be saved better for another opportunity, another message. We started the discussion with Joseph. Joseph resolved not to defile himself with Potiphar's wife. Now Moses, and it's referenced to Moses in the book of Hebrews, the word of the Lord says, in the chapter of faith, chapter 11, verse 23, here's what it says of Moses. By faith, Moses, when he was born, was hidden for 3 months by his parents because they saw he was a beautiful child, and they were not afraid of the king's command. By faith, Moses, when he became of age, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the passing pleasures of sin, esteeming the reproach of Christ greater than the riches of the treasures in Egypt. For he looked to his reward. By faith, he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, for he endured as seeing him who is invisible. Moses resolved not to defile himself with the temporal pleasures of Egypt. Instead, chooses to identify himself with God and God's people and suffer persecution. Now let's jump down in chapter 1. The verses 19 and 20. Let's see what it says. The king talked with them, and he found none equal to Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, so they entered the king's service. In every matter of wisdom and understanding about which the king questioned them, he found them 10 times better than all the magicians and enchanters in his whole kingdom. Now that is an extremely powerful statement. 10 times better. And that statement pivots on, but Daniel resolved not to defile himself. Without the Daniel resolved not to defile himself, you never have the king of Babylon found them to be 10 times better than all the magicians and enchanters in his whole kingdom. As you read through the book of Daniel, you get further evidence of the real reasons why that Daniel was, as stated by Gabriel, greatly beloved. As we read chapter 6 of Daniel, let's analyze and summarize the first 5 verses. Darius set up administrators and governors over the kingdom, of which Daniel was one. Daniel had proven himself worthy of the role to which he was assigned, so much so that the king was looking to promote him. Jealousy took hold of the other administrators and governors, and they sought to undermine Daniel. Here's an important point: using the power of the state to do it. Daniel, the fourth and final point, Daniel remained faithful to God. A little further down in verse 10, it states that he went home, and in his upper room, with his windows open toward Jerusalem, he knelt down on his knees 3 times a day and prayed and gave thanks before his God, as was his custom since early days. That's important. Young people, get in the habit of prayer. It is vitally important. This after he knew the law was signed, attacking his faith and religion. Oh, there's a lot to unpack there, enough for a sermon all its own. So when the consequences of his faith had been brought to Daniel, that had brought Daniel to the lion's den, he doesn't lash out against his accusers. He doesn't complain against the king or remind the king of how the king intended to promote him or cite his exemplary work service or sterling performance reviews. He knew what was stated by Moses in Exodus 14:14, repeated by David in 1 Chronicles 20. The battle is the Lord's. So off to the lion's den he goes, and God is with him there. And God saves him there. What Daniel says to King Darius after his rescue contains a few other lessons for us. The first being humility. Daniel's humility is the first thing that strikes me here. May the king live forever. Daniel addresses the king in the spirit of humility. In light of the ordeal that Daniel had just been through, that says a lot about him. He still recognizes the sovereignty of the king, and unlike his accusers, his humility before the king wasn't in pursuit of some self-serving or nefarious objective. Next, Daniel gives all glory to God. My God sent his angel, and he shut the mouths of the lions. They have not hurt me because I was found innocent in his sight. What that tells me is Daniel is concerned, first and foremost, perhaps only, with how God views him, and not necessarily how the king views him. It is important to note that doesn't preclude Daniel from addressing the king with honor and respect afforded him by his position as monarch. Daniel knows that Darius is the king, but Daniel also knows that Darius is the king because God has made him the king. Daniel doesn't assert his own worthiness as the cause for his rescue. And finally, Daniel speaks the truth in clear, concise, and unambivalent terms. He doesn't rail against his accusers. He speaks of himself and his relationship to the king. You know, sometimes there's a lot more to these stories than can be gleaned than on just a surface reading. Perhaps even greater evidence of Daniel's humility and character can be found in the first 20 verses of Daniel 9. Now, most of us are very familiar with Daniel 9, but I think a lot of times that we read it, our eyes are drawn down past the first 22 or 23 verses, right down to Daniel 9, 24 and 25, where the 70 weeks prophecy is discussed. But when we do that, we're depriving ourselves of some of the most vital portions of God's word. Not that it all isn't vital. All of God's word is vital. Daniel, in his prayer in Daniel 9, never once utters the words they, them, those people. It's always we and us. And the only I, me, or my that he ever says in reference is to my God. And as Daniel speaks or listens to the man Gabriel, Gabriel tells Daniel that he is greatly beloved. Now, I will ask you, saints, what higher commendation could any flesh and blood ever receive than an angel of heaven speaking with us face to face, telling us we are greatly beloved? So there it is. We've had three and a half points of illustration. Some of you may be sitting there thinking, these stories are great, Steve, but what does it mean to me? You know, and let's get to the application as I wrap this up. If you share my worldview where God, an almighty and all-powerful God, is sitting on the throne of the universe and remains sovereign over the affairs of men, and I hope everyone here shares that worldview, it's hard to look around at what's going on in the world where, as Isaiah states it, woe to those who call evil good and good evil, who put darkness for light and light for darkness, who put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter, Woe to those who are wise in their own eyes and prudent in their own sight. It's hard to look at what's going on in the world and not think that the events of this world are not winding to a close. Even those who I talk to who subscribe to an evolutionary worldview seem to agree that things cannot continue going the direction that they're going, with woe and destruction, without some force, supernatural or otherwise, being brought to bear on the situation to restore some semblance of order, whatever order they think that might be. But I invite you now, take a look around. Look at those people sitting next to you here in our sanctuary in the Annapolis Church, and know this, right? We, the Seventh-day Adventist Church, located here in Annapolis at 1996 Generals Highway, is a special church with a special message to be shared in our community and around the globe. We are at a very crucial point of world history. Through the spirit of prophecy, we have been given insight into the events that are about to occur in Earth's history, as Earth's history winds to a close. As God has promised, He will do nothing unless He reveals His secrets to His servants, the prophets. We have been given a clear window into what is about to unfold. Our calling is sure, and our direction to tell the world has never run clearer than it does this very day. But what does that have to do with any of the illustrations we covered this morning? We are not going to impress people. People who widely believe that God's universe is over 10 billion years old and growing older by leaps and bounds with our understanding of sanctuary symbolism. We are not going to impress them with our understanding of the 2300 days prophecy, with our understanding of how the fourth commandment is the seal of God containing His title, His authority, and His jurisdiction, or with our insight into the future through the spirit of prophecy. All these things are vital. They're crucial. And truthfully, they're indispensable. But as we reach people, we need to have something to give them. Something tangible and something real. And if you want something real, I'm going to say this shameless plug, come here on Friday night and join us as we go through the series from the close of probation to the new earth. But nonetheless, these aren't the means by which people will be reached. That isn't how Joseph reached Potiphar or Pharaoh. Wasn't how Moses became qualified to lead a nation of Israel. A nation that was over a million people once women and children were factored in. Nor was it how Daniel became a trusted advisor in two separate temporal kingdoms. Or what prompted Daniel to inform, or what prompted Gabriel to inform Daniel that he was greatly beloved. No. It was their love for their fellow people and their steadfast faithfulness to God. In her book, The Ministry of Healing, and you can find this on pages 469 and 470, Sister White says this, "The badge of Christianity is not an outward sign, not the wearing of a cross or a crown, but it is that which reveals the union of man with God by the power of His grace, manifested in the transformed character the world is to be convinced that God has sent His Son as the Redeemer. No other influence that can surround the human soul has such power as or influence as an unselfish life. The strongest argument in favor of the gospel is a loving and lovable Christian. A loving and lovable Christian is a faithful Christian. For as Christ said, or I'm sorry, as Paul said, Christ living in them. Or Jeremiah, thus saith the Lord, let not the wise man glory in his wisdom, let not the mighty man glory in his might, nor let the rich man glory in his riches, but let him who glories glory in this, that he understands and knows me, that I am the Lord, exercising loving kindness, judgment, and righteousness in the earth. For in these things I delight." That will be their source of strength. meeting people at the level of their need. That was the secret of Jesus' ministry. And I don't, or at least I shouldn't have to remind anyone here right now that Jesus spent a lot more time helping people and healing people than he ever did preaching. It is through meeting people at the level of their need that the innermost compartments of their hearts will become open to us. And it is then and there, once we gain their trust, an entrance into the secret places of the heart, we can unpack the treasure trove of blessings we have to share with them. The Sabbath, the sanctuary, the 2300 days prophecy, and how all of these things fit together in God's plan to redeem man. Or, as an esteemed brother likes to say, how to save sinners without saving sin. We encounter daily people who have a desperate need for what we have to offer, the peace that passes all human understanding. People who have questions to which we have the answers. Why is the world such a crazy place that gets crazier all the time? And how much crazier is it going to get? But before Jesus moved into the spiritual aspect of his evangelism, he came in contact with people at a far more basic level. The blind man, the centurion, the widow of Nain, even the wedding party at Cana. He met them there and met their temporal needs. Once he did that, he was able to turn their attention to other aspects of their lives and address their spiritual needs. Desiring the good of others and the needs of others, that will be the hallmark of reaching people with the end time message, the three angels message. That is the calling of who we are as a church, because once people see how much they care, we care, they'll care to listen to how much we know. Our closing hymn is Rescue the Perishing, and I will invite, I don't know what number it is in your hymnal, but 367, thank you, but I will invite Brother Cabina and Sister Grace up here.
But let us look at it in this way. This song was composed by Fanny J. Crosby. And Fanny J. Crosby was a blind woman. But let's look at it. Rescue the perishing. How can a blind person rescue somebody? How can? But there is very, very, very important point here. Rescue the perishing, care for the dying, snatch them in the pity from sin and grief. Weep over the erring one, lift up the falling, tell them of Jesus, the mighty to save. Rescue the perishing, care for the dying. This is in 4/4 time signature. So it is a marching song. So it's going to be 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Pam, 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 pam. So that's how it's going to be. Sister, right.
Waiting, waiting.
Father God, thank you. It's not going to be our intellect that saves us, Lord. It's not going to be how smart or how slick or how clever we think we are. Lord, it's going to be a Savior that died for us on Calvary. And Lord, there are people that need to hear that. Not that we're smart people. Not that we're clever or slick or, you know, ingenious or in any way, shape, or form. But people to know that Jesus died for them. Lord, and there are people going through all types of pain and suffering that we have no idea. Lord, help us be in tune to the trials that people are going through. Help us be aware of how we can help them through the trials and how we can point them to Jesus, who is indeed the author and finisher of our faith. Lord, as we depart this place, be with us. Send your Spirit to be upon us. Let us not walk off the path of righteousness that you have marked out, Lord, but let us attune our ear to the voice behind us saying, this is the path, walk ye in it. Be merciful to us, Lord. Again, not that we are a people deserving mercy, but because that is who you are as a merciful God. Lead us in those paths of righteousness, Lord. Keep us safe and protected from the snares of the evil one. This is our prayer in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.